Please note, this is a non-profit project. All participants gave their time free of charge. This project is not affiliated with English Heritage or the Duke of Somerset, who is a direct descendant of the Berry Pomeroy Seymours. All music and video footage, out with the footage taken as part of the investigation, is not affiliated to the project. The images and music were chosen by the director and editor to complement the experience. A full list of information and links to the copyright owners is in the description. We sincerely hope that you enjoy the first feature-length documentary ever made about Berry Pomeroy Castle's haunted heritage.
First arrived, my hands very cold, but I was actually shaking.
Right.
And I normally get cold hands when I'm tuning in.
Oh yeah.
But to actually physically feel a bit shaky, I know it's quite cold.
Right.
But it's like it's different kind of cold, yeah, isn't it? It's like an icy kind of cold, isn't it?
The tower, this area here, I was quite interested in because I wanted to slow down my walking as I'm walking in this direction,
right?
And I'm almost quite somber but very serious at the same time walking through here.
I'm a spiritual medium. I'm also the founder of Haunted Plymouth. I run the Ghost Walks there. Been doing that since 2009. I've also been investigating the paranormal for almost 20 years, and I've written a couple of books also on the subject. Very passionate about the paranormal and history, and I'm also a Reiki master. My dad was in the Navy.
Okay.
On leave, he would take us up to the moors, tell us about the legends and stories of the Hairy Hands, Kitty Jays, and he gave us a little book, and it was all about the legends of Dartmoor. I started reading it before you know it. My book collection grew and grew from the age of about 6, 7, and then I was just thrived into the subject, and then I went on a ghost walk many, many years ago. And then
Where was that?
That was down in St. Ives, actually.
Okay.
Many years ago. I've always had a thirst for the paranormal, Arthur C. Clarke, watching his programmes.
Yeah.
And then went on a ghost walk with Ian, joined his group, was on the committee, and then we were based at Pangurst. Yeah. And that kind of brought me to, just investigate the paranormal. Left that group at the time, went our separate ways, as you do, and then set up another group called SRUK, which I've done for 10 years. Supernatural Investigations UK.
Yeah.
The group's still running today, but obviously I felt that I wanted to go off in another direction, so I let the guys carry on doing what they want to do. Obviously, throughout the whole investigating side of things, been developing my mediumship, and I just love history, paranormal,
right.
And that's kind of where I am now, and it's nice to meet like-minded people.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, fantastic, yeah. Likewise. Yeah. Yeah.
investigate with another team called Haunted Devon in 2006. I was invited along as a guest. And it was a pleasure to do this because I've always wanted to investigate buried Pomeroy. And I had a couple of experiences here. First one was in the kitchen area. I believe it was the kitchen area. And they were picked up on the spirit of a young girl called Isabel. And I was quite intrigued. She was intrigued, like, why we're here. I was using my days and rods at the time.
Were you aware of the history of the place?
No, I knew it was a haunted castle,
right.
But I always go into a place, unless it's very well known, obviously,
right.
I don't want to know.
Right.
So I've heard that Barry Pomeroy, I know I've read books a lot, but right. I wasn't aware of anything.
So you never came across the name Isabel?
No.
Connected?
No. Okay. Afterwards, I've done some research,
right.
As you do, just
yeah.
Curious.
Yeah.
But, so I picked up on this young girl, Isabel. I got the impression she was a young girl that passed in the castle. I could see in my mind's eye an image of what happened. She was in the kitchen, something happened, and she got hit and fell over, and she died from her injuries. So I was picking this information up. She seemed to be following the group around, and then I got in the Great Hall as well. And to the point where I went home that night after the investigation, it's one of the only times I felt there was something still with me. And I got my days and rods out with Crystal, and I was just checking. And lo and behold, Isabel had followed us home.
Right.
So I was like, okay, thank you for coming, but please could you go back to where you come from?
So when
from?
You say us, there was more than...
Yeah, it's just her had followed me home.
Oh, right, okay.
Because I drove home on my own.
Right,
I just had the impression that there was someone with me in the car. Even
right.
Though the car was empty, it's just me. I just felt comfortable. I didn't feel I was alone. So I said, could you please return? And she did, because after days and again, it seemed all quite settled. This is one of the only times I've actually, something has followed me home.
Right.
But I think she was more intrigued more than anything, to be honest. And then
yeah.
I did a bit of research. I was like, found out a bit about it. I was like, wow.
I was about to leave when just by the rampart walls and the stairs leading down, I saw this huge black cloud. And to me, it seemed probably the hugest and blackest, deepest thing I'd ever seen.
Dalby claims the black cloud, what he terms the evil entity, trailed him through the castle, then followed him back to his house nearby. That same night, he tried to use a Ouija board to make contact with the terrifying presence.
Is there anybody there? Aye. Yes.
The glass moved erratically around the board, which was very unusual at the time. And then she made herself known. She popped up.
Isabel.
She struck as a very evil little girl.
Through the Ouija board, they met a little girl named Isabel, who revealed that she was the bastard child of a disinherited Pomeroy from the 17th century. The Dolbys believe she spoke through the board and then actually appeared hours later in the Dolby bedroom.
I actually went to bed early and left the group downstairs experimenting with the Ouija board, and actually had the experience of somebody sitting on the back of my legs while I was lying on the bed. Thinking it was Bob messing about, I told him to get off, turned around, and it was actually a little girl with just a manic grin on her face.
Well, they both came to see me the next afternoon. They were so terrified. And I can tell you that they were frozen with shock.
I think also what I find fascinating is sometimes we're lighting on these little clouds, an insect aware of one particle, but it has an intelligent movement and it might change direction all of a sudden.
Yeah.
That is more question for debate. But as I said, I'm quite
skeptical.
Well,
yes.
That's sort of stuff that we got from the investigation we did that somewhere I won't talk about now. But it was an empty room. And there was like a central metal pillar holding up the roof and full of scaffolding. And there was only one PowerPoint. So all our equipment came out with one PowerPoint.
Yeah.
So we had loads of extension leads all over the floor. And then we'd leave the building secure and just let the cameras do their thing. And we'd come back and start watching. And several occasions we got some interesting orbs. One appeared at the end of the room, and you see it traveling towards the camera. As soon as it touches one of the cables, it starts to follow.
Oh, I remember that one.
Yeah,
I remember that.
Scaffolding poles was like in a sort of pyramid shape. You see this orb appear on one of the bars and moving along, and then jumps to the one behind.
Yeah.
So again, that's not dust or insect, but something with some sort of thought behind it. So yeah, those are sort of good examples that I would put money on, they are
definitely.
Yeah.
Spiritual. As I said, 100% believe, it's just sometimes you've got to rule out, especially with...
But then where you've got a medium present that can corroborate, yes, there was something here, there's exactly. Two married together.
Yeah.
So that's where the best investigations come, where you've got...
Exactly.
Catching something on camera and a medium, backing it up.
So that's why. That's how I like to work as well. Tech and mediumship, so they back each other.
You've got to look at other explanations, because everything can be explained. But once you've ruled all the natural phenomena out, then you think, well, it's got to be spirit.
It's quite helpful.
But I've,
The
thing is, people post so many old photographs on my pages, because I've got two pages now. I don't know if you were aware of that. I mean, recently, and you can see it's clear as day. Someone picked. Captures an orb on the grass. You can clearly see a woman wearing a red dress, and you can see the face and you can see a hat. But this orb is not—it's like an orb I've never even seen before. It was absolutely amazing. I mean, if you saw it, Dave, I don't know if you've seen it, but I'll send it to you.
This is static, still.
Still camera, but you can see the colours. You've got the reds, you've got like.
And then this was taken at night.
This was taken at night time. Right. Yeah, it was over by the wall. You know, like, do you know where the bush is?
Right,
behind the bush, you've got the gatehouse, the side of the gatehouse. It was over there. But
and then again, you've got the flash phenomenon as well that can pick up on. And then, especially if you've got like an image in there, it'd be quite possible for someone to be standing out of shot.
Something out of shot. And,
in a flash, and if there is this orb that's reflecting,
could
pick up something that looks like it's inside, but it's not. And then that's where you need, other information to back it up.
Whether it be
whoever was present, what they were wearing, and all those sort of details you need to, from a scientific point of view, you've got to rule out.
Yeah, you've got to rule everything. Things that you don't even think of.
Fortunately, because of that, and if you haven't got the backup, then you have to sort of. So your experiences then, did you know much about the history of the castle before you came?
Yeah, we looked it all up and we researched it.
Okay.
We moved about a bit, but before the benches were here, I brought down my own chair and I sat here.
Right.
And just taking random photos, and all of a sudden something kicked my chair. So I thought, and it all went a bit cold around me.
Right.
So I got my camera out. And I thought I'd just take a couple of photos, and it just went bang. So I checked the lens, checked that it was working, it seemed fine, took another photograph, and it was a real big bang. Another photograph, and it was a real big bang. And that was it. My camera just went bang and kaput. Didn't work again. But it was horrible here. It was very dark, very cold, very horrible experience. So when I moved on to the grass, this is where I got my horse and rider, because I don't normally stay down this end of the castle. I'm usually up that end.
Right.
And this is where I got the picture of the horse and rider.
This is the still picture. It's not one that's
not moving. It's still. No.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So your background, and you're a medium.
No, I'm just a spirit hunter.
Okay.
Ghost hunter.
Right.
Maybe
okay.
Paranormal.
Have you seen other things elsewhere, or just?
I've seen. I've taken photographs. I've taken about 2,000 photos.
Right.
And I think about 10 are really good.
These are all here, or
all
here?
This is all here.
Right.
I've been to Trinity and I got fire.
Okay.
Because it's been burnt down twice.
Trinity Church at Buckfastleigh.
Yeah.
Right. Are you local to here?
Yeah. I used to come down here when I was a child.
Okay. Yeah. You've never been sensitive to spirit then? You've never seen.
No.
Spirit?
No.
It's always just been what you've picked up.
Yeah.
On
normally
camera.
I don't feel anything. I've been down here with people and they'll go, "Oh, did you feel that?" And normally I don't. But when I was there, then I felt the cold, and I did feel uneasy, which is very unusual for me because normally it don't bother me.
Right.
But I did feel uneasy. But other times it seems very peaceful down here.
So as we can see now, this is like the road into the castle. So what made you sit on the road? Was this at night or
night?
Okay, right.
Because I'm normally over that side or over there. I thought I'm going to try here.
Okay.
Just to see and try different parts because I've sat over there. But here it was just, I didn't like it. There was something not right about it.
All right.
But when it kicked my chair, it was really hard.
Did it kick it over, or you just felt the vibration?
Vibration.
Right, okay.
Quite hard. And that's when I thought, well, I think I'd better take some photos, because obviously something's going on here.
Something's trying to get your attention.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when I come up here, I always make sure I open and I close.
Right.
To keep myself grounded and safe, and always respectful.
So who were you with then on that occasion?
I come down with Trina. She can't be here today because she's a bit busy. But normally we come down. The first time we ever come down, when we come down the pass, we had stones thrown at us, but it was like cobble on cobble.
Right.
That crack.
Yeah.
When we first, and so we come down here and we thought, right, we'll just be a little bit cautious. So then we started opening up and closing to make sure we're safe.
So does she see spirit then again, or just?
She takes photos. Sometimes she does. She'll feel them.
Right.
She don't see them, but she'll feel them.
Okay.
Which is pretty good, because I can be guided by her. She'll say, "Oh, I don't feel a bit. I feel a bit easy or uneasy." So.
And as. Your husband, has he ever come down here?
No. He likes the history.
Right.
He loves history. He's just been telling me all about bits and pieces about the castle was built and that.
Lee Hunter, I'm a spiritualist medium. I do platform. I also do house cleansings and weddings and all of it. I just connect that way. So it's using each of the senses of different frequencies. And I like connecting. I like seeing what's in buildings and feeling and stuff like that. Everything's different. Everywhere's different. Every day's different. So
what sort of age did you start realising you had this gift?
I started sitting in the circle 21 years ago, so I've been working, doing platform and that sort of stuff for 21 years. Do paranormal investigations.
Right. So it wasn't something you had as a child that you saw?
My mum used to sit in a circle, I'd sit in the room with them and I could feel them around and that sort of stuff.
Right.
But I didn't actually develop it until I was about 30 or something.
Right.
So yeah, so a bit of time, but I was aware of it, I just never did anything.
Right. Okay. And so you've been to Berry Pomeroy before, but it's only at night?
I've only been outside twice at night.
Right.
I've never been inside. I've not done much, literally probably an hour and a half each time.
Right.
I've got no experience or the history or anything.
Right.
I keep out of that. If I'm going somewhere, I don't even know.
Right. So you said you had an experience on the driveway?
Yeah, it's coming in the driveway as you come down, you literally feel like you're being chased. You can feel hear footsteps, you know people are watching you.
Right.
And you could say it's paranoia because it's dark, but you literally audibly hear them. It's not just in one mind playing tricks or anything.
Was it a group of you?
There was about four of us, I think, at the time.
And did you all experience the same
thing? Yeah, we were all practically running from the car.
Right. How long ago was that, Lee? Do you remember?
Probably about 5-6 years ago.
Oh, it's not that long ago, is it?
Yeah, it's about 5-6 years ago.
Okay.
Literally, we stood out on the front lawn and we had a bit of a mist there, but that dissipated. A bit of a mist towards the toilet block. But there wasn't an awful lot. That's really all I experienced. You know, people kept on talking about looking in the windows, like windows and stuff like that, but I didn't really see anything to be fair at that point.
Right.
So I've never been inside, never been back actually.
You also mentioned about the tree outside.
So yeah, the tree just outside the building, onto the left of the building as you go out, there's an old tree there, but I know that...
Wishing tree.
There's been hangings. I know that I could see the hangings there. It wasn't a pleasant place for me.
It was definitely negative.
And I know that somebody said, his name was, that there's a hanging tree further down, but that's not where I got it. I got it outside there.
Right. Because the wishing tree is called the wishing tree because the idea is if you walked around it so many times, made a wish, that it would come true. So you're getting a completely different vibe.
Very different. I felt that was almost like there was, I don't know how many words, but I can definitely see that there was a hanging there at one point. It's almost like a warning kind of thing.
Okay. Like with magpies or crows, they'd hang them up just to sort of ward off.
Kind of thing, but not as in a dark side of it like that, as much more the fact that I could just see it hanging there. So either if somebody took themselves over or whether they were it was a punishment, I don't know. But I definitely felt that there was a hanging there.
Was it male or female?
Male.
Okay. We came inside.
Yeah.
And what were your first impressions then, as you came through the gates?
Lots of different energies, lots of different things.
Right.
I was drawn over to that side over there where there's a little bow in the wall.
Right.
And there was a woman there crying for a song. I heard that.
Oh right. Wow.
I didn't get any details of how she was. She was just saying. I wrote that.
Okay.
My son.
Right.
I just heard that, and I know there's a woman that was crying, looking out from that window or that viewpoint.
Over the valley?
From just where that tall bit of the
right
side there, there's a bowing
wall. Oh, okay, yeah. Wow, okay.
And I stood there looking out, saying my son, I see that.
Okay.
I also saw a kind of irrelevant, a red and gold shield with a blue stripe to it.
Right.
So I don't know if that's to do with the family suit of arms or anything like that, but red and gold with a blue stripe.
Okay.
A blue light.
Going back to the woman saying, my son, did you get the impression that she was looking at something there, or that was just where she was looking when she got that?
Well, I was trying to stick to looking out,
looking
so I
out.
Don't know if she was seeing it or whether that was a morning place, but I was just looking out there and I just felt that I was hearing the words, my son,
right.
And I felt blue stricken, but I was looking that way.
Because there's one of the legends about place, which is a legend, probably, actually happened somewhere else in the locality, but the castle pinched the story. This idea of the Pomeroy brothers jumping over the battlements on their horses.
I have no idea. I've not heard anything. That's good. I purposely haven't even looked at that page because I don't want to know anything about it.
But it's interesting that looking out over the ramparts in that direction is, where allegedly these two guys jumped off. So could this have been the mother in the legend, grieving for a son who just jumped off the wall on his horse?
It was gut-wrenching. I could feel it in my stomach, the upset. That's all I can tell you is I felt the grief. And my son, I kept staring out that way.
So she'd actually just witnessed, maybe?
I can't say 100%. All I can say is I felt the gut-wrenching. As I looked, he stood there, held on the end of the wall, looking out. That's when I heard it.
Right.
When I was viewing that way, I was staring that way.
That's really interesting. Yeah.
I know I saw someone hanging from that tree once.
Right.
But I didn't see multiple. I saw someone, but that's to me. If people would say a hanging tree, that's where I would have chosen, because that's to me. That's what the feeling I've got.
Right.
So I know somebody would have been hanging from there.
Yes. Okay. Did you get the impression? Was it a suicide, or they were done as it was?
Well, this is what I'm saying. I'm not sure. As I'm talking to you now, it feels much more that somebody was bereft, someone was upset and considering a more suicide than punishment. But originally it felt as if it was a warning to people, kind of thing.
Right.
But it feels more like it's, as I'm talking to you, that's how it feels.
Right.
It feels more like somebody took themselves there.
Right. Okay. But I think, I don't think, there was, knowing the history of the place, again, there was no evidence of there being any attacks here or sieges or anything. So for someone to sort of be strung up for a punishment, they wouldn't have had that sort of legality.
This is what I'm saying
here
to you just now. It always feels as if that it was somebody who is outside of the house. It's not outside the grounds.
No.
Grounds, but it's close enough to the house for someone to do it.
Yeah.
It feels much more like that.
Okay.
Pomeroy. I've got Pembury.
Pembury could be somebody. Right. Yeah, we can look into that and then we'll probably find out.
Really,
that.
Really.
Okay.
So, and you say that.
Pembury, is it?
Pembury.
Yeah. Sorry, what's the first name?
Either Robert or Roger, I've got.
Roger or Robert Pembury, yeah. Right, we have to try and remember that. I'm trying to research that a little bit. Yeah, I'll have to research that, Pembury.
He was a member of Parliament, born in Sandridge, Devon. Pomeroy was the head of a Devonshire family. In 1685, he was returned as a Tory for Dartmouth. He wasn't popular among his constituents, who were reported in 1688 to be ready to elect any court candidate except Pomeroy. He may have visited the castle when he was in office.
I know people have seen reflections of foot, seen reflections of windows or glass here. I can see,
yeah.
I can see that. I'm getting that as well.
Oh, you're getting reflections of what? In the windows?
So if you're looking at the windows from outside,
yeah.
And there's like a reflection.
Right.
Nothing there at all, no. Place reflection, but right. It appears as if there's glass there and there isn't there. I have that as well. And then you can just feel. The energy, you just feel like shaping and like a vortex.
Right.
So I grabbed Kev and Christine and got them to go and stand in it. And you can feel the energy in there, it's just a whole different thing, but it's not as if it's just been used for cooking. There's other reasons for it being used. I mean, you picked up on
It felt like someone had been punished, pushed into the fire and then out again quickly.
Oh, wow.
Like they've been like they do. Branding. Yeah, but it's literally fine, and I'm sick. I don't know if there's been things found, but it felt to me like this, and we found it in that part of the fireplace. It might even be self-cooking, just something that was found and recovered from there.
That side didn't bother me, that side is the one that I know that's what we're focused on there. But there's definitely very strong energy in there, in that area. Now, I know, obviously, it would have been used quite a lot, but it doesn't feel to me. Now, I know, obviously, it would have been used quite a lot, but it doesn't feel to me. Now, I know, obviously, it would have been used quite a lot, but it doesn't feel to me. That's not what I was picking up on. I was kind of getting similar to you. Definitely an energy for a younger person in here.
So when you say used, as in for cooking purposes, or...?
I don't know that it was... I'm...
What, are you getting the same impression for both, or just...
No, that's the one I'm focusing on. That there, I'm not sure what it is, but that side, that's the one I'm focused on. So when I get in there and I look up, it feels here to me, whereas you go to that side. Yeah. I feel that side, I felt more of an energy, and it's almost like a vortex. When you stand there, you get the shaking going up through.
Right.
That's how it feels to me, a spinning vortex of energy there. So I don't know if there's been... seeing activity seen here, where people have said they've seen lights here or seen things here at night.
Talk about things being found, but I was saying earlier, they had people that would come in and do reenactments more recently, and one night they were allowed to sort of stay here.
Right, okay.
And one of them, who had quite an elaborate suit of armour and a nice helmet, he actually sort of, I'm sure it was this one, I'm not sure it was that one, but we'll say it was this one. He bedded down in the fireplace,
right.
And in the morning the helmet had gone.
Right, okay.
Never to be seen again.
Well, that's, for me, that part there, you feel, if you stand in there, you'll feel the energy. I mean, right. I don't know if you've stood in there or not. If you stand there and try and stand still, you should feel wobbly.
I felt buzzing in my ears and I ducked under.
I mean, you can logic that's because you've got a tunnel above you, but the reality is, if you tuned in, you get that. You get the shaking going through this in the vortex. So to me, this is one place. If I came at night, this is one place I would be because that's
that's strong energy. It's very strong energy. Yeah, you're picking up on the energy, which is kind of like it's kind of like in your face, isn't it?
Again, it's a bit odd. The fact you've got a great lump of rock in there. So imagine that being used as a sort of fireplace. You would have thought they'd want more of a smooth. Bottom to it, but
that could be a warming place. If there's a fire here, they'd have to go to warming with hands and that. Yeah, I've got somebody who'd stand there with the hand on there and talk to people. He'd address the people by standing there.
Yeah.
But it's obviously the kitchen area is the bit over the far side.
Yeah.
So, like we're saying, would they actually have cooked here, or would it just have been for, keeping stuff warm boss, they were having a meal.
I'm not seeing the busyness of the kitchen. I'm just feeling the fire there, and there's something in those corners. But that, as I say, that one, I don't know. I'm not drawn to that one at all, but that one is the one I'm drawn to. But it just feels to me as if somebody would stand there and be talking to people here, entertaining or instructing in here. Do you also know if there's a private chapel here? I know there's a little private chapel.
Private chapel, there is, yes.
Yeah, I don't see anything else. Yeah. Because they're talking to me about there was this village church, but to write a private chapel space, there'd be a space in here that the lady or something would go and have her own space.
Yes.
I've got a gold cross.
I'm familiar with that.
And I've got a gold candlestick with a couple of stones in it.
Okay.
But I know it's a sacred, it's a quiet space, and I don't know if it was where they had to hide away that part of religion or whatever, but I know there's a secret, that space there for religion. I'm being shown here. When we stood here, we walked in here first, me and Christine, and I said about a couple of space. Because I know that it's a very private couple. It's a very private thing, and I don't know if it's to do with different religions or anything, but this is their space, and it wasn't for anyone else to go in, but family. It's a very private place. It could just be the lady who was here. I literally said to you about a chapel down here. I don't want to know anything, that's why I don't talk. I just know I can see the cross, I can see the candlestick. It's not a lot of gold there with it, it's just some basic, but it is enough for the family. It's all private.
Well, maybe, you know, the pregnant woman didn't really want to be excommunicated, so they gave her like a little cross and a candle that she could still pray to. She was in isolation.
I was still in that first room when I said about it, so I don't know where she would have kept or where it is. I don't know if there's a photograph of the cross that would link in or the candlesticks. I can see it. It's not massively lit, but I can see the metal.
I took a photograph, just random, and it was by the benches, and it was a big orb. And when I zoomed in, it was a beautiful picture of a child.
Okay.
And she was, her hair was like this.
She was there, yeah.
Then I took one of the castle, and I thought it looked like bubblegum when you look at it. When I zoomed in, it was a face, complete face with a collar, with the bits that come down here.
Right.
Then weeks later, because obviously I can't remember where I stood, I just took another photograph, and it was there again. The same face.
Has it always been the same camera that you've used?
Roughly, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, because I had to buy a new one, because this one just blew up, so...
Right, yeah. That was like a proper camera or a phone camera?
Oh, it was a proper camera.
Proper camera.
So, cyber shot, wasn't it?
I just take loads of photos.
Right.
And until you go home, you need to put them on a computer, really.
Okay.
As I say, I'd take 2,000. No, I went and bought another camera. Exactly the same.
But you said the night it blew up, you got the pictures of the horse? Or is that a separate occasion?
No, that was before.
Before it blew up?
Yeah, before it blew up.
Got you.
Yeah. Okay. Because I didn't realise that, because I'm just doing this, you know.
Although it blew up, it still retained the pictures that it already taken.
Yeah, because that was on. It was obviously stuck on the memory card.
Right.
It was a camera, it just wouldn't work, I couldn't open it.
Right.
The lens wouldn't go in and out.
Right.
So I just threw that away and just bought another one.
So you don't smoke?
No.
Or vape?
No.
No. And the people you come with?
Most doesn't either, does she?
The camera is always arm length.
Yeah. Right,
and when it's cold and you've got the breath, it's always turn your head away, hold your breath, take a photo.
And with the flash or...?
Yeah, I've got an external flash. Sometimes I've got to use that because it's so dark and it just lights the whole place up. Sometimes it's all right and it looks like snow. So I've got to not use it.
Right.
So I try to get in between just as it's going down.
Right. You see, the problem I have with this is all this stuff is appearing on your cameras.
Yeah.
Yet nothing is being seen with the naked eye.
No.
It just seems a bit odd that whatever it is that's not performing is the wrong word, but whatever is making an attempt to manifest isn't attempting to allow you to see it with the naked eye. It's relying on the equipment to manifest. And
I was actually having that conversation with Christine last night, and she said from her experience with spirit that quite a lot of the times people take photographs and you won't always see them with the naked eye, but the camera has an ability to pick up on that spirit or things that you can't actually see.
Yeah.
Whereas yours tend to be more, apart from the orbs, that the horse is just like a misty, black and white sort of shape. Because my theory is that obviously if a modern day ghost, you would see the colours. So you'd see it like a real person. But as time's gone by, years, centuries, whatever, that colour dissipates. So it becomes more like your classic white lady or a misty shape.
Well, I don't know, because, do you know, like you hear mediums say that sometimes spirits can appear the way they want to appear. Sometimes you'll see them as like shadowy shapes, and sometimes they're transparent. But then sometimes they can appear solid, can't they?
Yeah.
So I was listening to Christine Matthews, and she was saying the same thing, that spirits can just appear like you and me, solid. But
when she sat down beside the cafe, the shop, she was talking to the cook, Christine Matthews.
Right, okay.
She was talking to the cook, and the cook was laughing at our clothes and wanting to know why we're out on our own and all that. I mean, obviously she can communicate. We couldn't see nothing. We were, just listening to the conversation.
And why was you accompanied by a man, wasn't it?
The cook can understand why we were on our own. Women were on our own.
Okay. When you were here with her that night, then, were you taking pictures of her while she was...
No, we were just sat down on the grass.
Right.
Listening to what Chrissy was saying.
Can you remember the actual area where she was actually communicating?
Yeah, it was just beside the shop. We were sat on the grass.
I was over there,
behind the shop on this side.
Okay.
And,
But did you take any pictures that night when you were here?
Most probably, but I couldn't tell you what I took.
Right. So nothing springs out that rarefies what she was picking up on?
No.
So that's a shame. Because that would have been interesting, because if she was sensing stuff around her, then if you'd taken pictures, then you might well have got something.
Yeah, I think I was more absorbed in what she was saying.
From a sort of a scientific sort of experimental point of view, then it's good to have the pictures, it's good to have what a medium says, but what you need to do is to link the two together, and then you've got evidence that is irrefutable then.
We'll take a lot of energy. So we draw energies, we go investigate,
sure.
Look at the amount of batteries we all can bring out.
Yeah.
Whether that's atmosphere as well. But my experience is they draw energy
they can. Yeah.
And to manifest we'll take a lot. So if they can only appear as a slight mist or a wisp, then possibly, that's the amount of energy they can draw at that time.
There's a local that's been coming down here since the 70s, and she's about five times that's happened to her. Every time she's come down here, not anywhere else, where her battery's died in the car. And she had to call out the AA, because her battery's died in the car,
But in here, it's nice to revisit, because the last time we were here in 2006, we were doing some calling out down here as well. And it's myself, a couple of people in here. I think it was more so we heard footsteps on the stairs. We were calling out and the wind hiccups. we also heard, what else did we hear? The wind, it was quite a still night. And all of a sudden the wind picked up. Out of nowhere whilst we were calling out, I thought that was quite intriguing. Was it natural? Obviously the wind's natural, but it just seemed at that prominent point, activity.
But
today was interesting coming back down because it was different feelings again, different layers in here. Lots of experiences. Funny enough, Matt, to your left, I've got the image of a woman, young girl.
Okay.
Sat there, very smartly dressed. I could see the silks. I'd say she's probably about 18 to 20.
but she had almost like this thing on a headdress kind of effect. But it was more so where it's like double layered, so it's like silks underneath and it was white on top. And she sat there, she had a Bible. She sat there and I felt she would come here quiet. Like, and the impression was getting she was nobility, family of work.
Yeah.
She sat down here quiet time. The other thing I got here was smells. I mean, smell almost like bread.
Okay. Oh, bread, yeah.
Bread, I don't know if that's before. And there's also a black Labrador just sat here.
Okay. Oh, that one you picked up earlier?
Yeah, that was early taste. So those three things for today, just coming down here.
Well, I reckon that was Margaret, you know, when you said about the vowel on her head. So. But then many people over the years have heard the sounds of horses galloping.
Yeah.
Many years, like
sounds are different.
Like a reenactment, couldn't it be?
Yeah.
And that could be a reenactment. Before we know, you know, they might not even be aware of you. You know, it might just be something that happened many years ago that's imprinted itself in the atmosphere.
Well, one of my experiences was of gunfire.
Oh, the musket fire. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, I was here. It was September. My family were visiting, and we were out in the hall here, just looking out over the valley. And all of a sudden, we started hearing gunshots, but it wasn't modern guns, this was like volleys of shots going off. And it doesn't sound like it's coming from the field, it sounded like it was coming from a distance. And what I didn't do was go into another part of the castle and see if I could still hear it. But you know, those who were with me at the time heard it. And history books say there was never any skirmishes or any battles here, so it wasn't something pertaining to the castle. Mm. But doing a bit of research, you come up with Dornerfield, which is a farm just up the road towards Newnabbot, that's now a caravan site, but it's got an old farmhouse there, and they did have at one time a cannonball actually embedded in the wall, and they took it out and it was on display in the hallway for people to see. It's gone now. But I'm wondering whether what we experienced was a playback of the event where that skirmish occurred, and it was just coming back down the valley on the wind. And,
because sound travels, isn't it? So it could be, probably what that is.
You do get, well, back in the day, you used to get those gun bird scarers.
But
it wasn't that sound. It was definite boom, boom,
boom,
after the other.
Yeah.
And then I, not just that occasion, but another time I was coming down the lane at night, and I heard it again then. In the dark, and I do a lot of walking on the moors, and
did you hear
got the army there that would do night shots. It wasn't like that, you know, you wouldn't get the volleys being fired in the dark, but as I was saying, you might get them up on the moors. But because I do walking on the moors and leopard boxing, I'm used to looking up the firing times, and I did check, and there was nothing, no activity on the moor that night, so it wasn't coming from that distance.
It's interesting you say that, because I was going to ask you, because I had experience walking with Christine earlier by the chapel. As soon as I walked into the chapel area, I had a very loud muffling sound in my left ear, almost as if something had gone off like a shot. And almost my eyesight, everything went black all of a sudden. I just felt very disorientated.
Oh, wow.
And I wasn't sure if that had been picked up before. But that was over by the chapel.
One single.
And my ear and my left ear went. And I wasn't sure if someone had been brought to the chapel laid there, because I got the impression they'd been injured. They were laid there.
Right.
So was I tapping into their experience themselves?
Okay.
And I just wanted to inquire with yourselves if that had been picked up before. It's quite interesting because we're both linking into certain things at the same time, energies.
Right.
And over on the other towers as well, we're picking up on various things, energies. But quite different.
Apart from the bread smell, have you had any other smells whilst you've been here today?
Only the bread smell here. Oh, there's a smell of, I know there's a lot of farmyard smells going around, but it's almost like fish smell coming. Just as we start to come down these stairs here, there's almost like a smell of fish. Okay. Mm. But I wasn't sure if that was smelling something else.
Because what I've been getting, and Sandy and Paul were getting it, this was picked up when we were talking to Bob in the cloisters, and then when we sat up on the ramparts here. But it's that smell of what's
very acrid.
Because I get a lot on the moors. We've got a dead sheep.
Yeah.
It's the smell that gives off.
Yeah.
So it's getting that smell.
Yeah.
But there's obviously no dead animals. But that in several different parts, and it's like,
okay.
going around. I could smell Sandy's perfume, and then we got the smell of.
So I can smell that smell now, actually. Can you smell it? We picked up on musky smell, didn't we? Earlier, that's the smell. Almost like a rotten fish. Or fish, or sheep, is what I see.
But that is the smell, then.
Yeah, that's it.
There's quite a few things walking around today compared to when I was here last time. Obviously, I picked up on various spirits, pasture accidents, etc. But, I just find it intriguing how the energy, you know, the different levels here, so many different things. Sometimes. Personally, two things. Compared to last time, it's been many years, but obviously I've been developing over the years as well.
Yeah.
So whether my awareness has heightened a bit more, but it does feel very active.
In the daytime, yeah.
Definitely aware there's a lot going on.
A lot going on, yeah. But they just don't want to show themselves, do they?
No, I think they're quite reserved. I mean, they're intrigued that we're here.
But they don't need to, though, that's what really, do they? When you think about it.
I just think it's so much. I don't feel anything negative.
Do you think about the amount of people that come here? Do you think the people that like to experiment and dabble?
I feel
devil worship and all that sort of stuff.
Quite the main entrance, I feel there's a lot of energy there. You know where you've got the main green?
Oh yeah,
and, I mean, there's, I can secure the area as well. I was picking up stuff today as well. But was there anyone ever? Has anyone ever picked up here? It's almost, I feel like they're a guard of some kind, but they've got like the helmet's kind of it's a helmet on top.
Yeah,
and it's almost they've got a big fake. Red and orange.
Why do you say that, Kevin? But they're almost like a guard. There's a famous picture. I don't believe it's a brickwork because you can see the mesh.
Okay.
There's a picture on my page of the, you know, the gatehouse. I think it's the first tower. You know, you've got the gun sort of the guns.
Okay.
You can see a guard in there, but it's definitely not a brickwork.
Yeah.
You don't know obviously what the brickwork looks like, but you can see the mesh and you can see the helmet in the face.
Yeah.
Have you seen the picture?
I don't think I have, but it's almost like there's a bit of a lip on the helmet. It's quite on the top.
But you can see the helmet.
You can see the orange and the red, and it's kind of, you know, like almost like silk effect.
Tony Cornell walked the castle grounds with Jack Hazard, the former master stonemason of Barry Pomeroy. It was while working here in 1986 that Hazard captured what many consider the most authentic photographic evidence of a ghostly presence here.
It started to rain, and the wind started to blow. And I thought there was something happening unusual. So I got the disc camera out, and I took five or six shots. And on five of the prints, white shapes came out. Whatever they were, I've no idea, but it was a most unusual Sunday morning.
I didn't see any, I got a photograph, but I didn't see an awful lot down there. But what I did with here was why, and then crying, why, and crying, that's all I heard. I don't understand the context. Now, I know there's stories about Barry Pomeroy and the tower, but I can't say if it's related to that. That's all I know.
Yeah.
All I know is I heard a woman crying, saying, why, and then crying. Why, and crying. That's all I heard. I do know from looking out this, the window down there, there must have been a fire somewhere over there at one point. But I'm looking out the window and I can see a fire. So,
in the trees?
That way, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So I could see a fire, and I was being shown that somebody would have looked through that window and seen the fire. I don't know when, I don't know who. All I know is I've got that viewpoint of a fire through that little slit window down there.
So are we talking like a fire coming out of a chimney, or just a fire raging in the trees?
Yeah, right, okay. not a controlled fire, distant one.
Right.
And also looking out, would you understand about some kind of processionary thing that would have gone in front of here? I saw like a trailer with wood or spawn or something being pulled in front of here at one point, ceremonially, in front of the house. Has anybody ever mentioned that?
I think so. No, it's a ceremony, but there probably were ceremonies back in the day.
As in, like for harvest sort of thing?
It's like a trailer, what do you call it, a cart, like that kind of thing. But it's being pulled along in front, and I know that there's people walking with torches either side, and I know that you've got the corn, you've got wood, you've got all that kind of thing there. And I can just see it being pulled in front.
Right. It's not like someone's going to be burnt at the stake or anything like that.
It's not showing to me like that. Right. I'm just being shown this.
Like a religious
kind of thing. Right. Yeah. Okay. So I don't know what the pagan is like around here, but it could be very natural like that. It could be in the villages.
Yeah, right.
Could
anyway. Be.
Yeah.
But I'm not getting it as being a burnt at the stake thing.
No, okay.
I'm just getting more as a celebration. You know, you've got torches, you've got the trailer.
Right.
I can see people going in front. But
was it going to the tree?
I was seeing it from, I can see it from the slit window down there, right. So that viewpoint. And it would have been coming across, it would have gone in front of the house. Right. So from the driveway and across in front as well, right. I've seen it.
Okay. Probably a procession. So
it is a procession. And I don't think whether it was druidry and that sort of stuff, but it's natural because you've got the corn, you've got the wood, you've got the fire, you've got all of the things you'd have with the paganist.
Right.
And natural stuff. So it could just be a different layer of history up there. It's no negativity, it's much more celebratory and offering.
A voluntary offering.
Yeah, I don't know what serfs are. When serfs come into history, they leave serfs. Yeah. But that's the kind of thing.
Right.
But very on the ground, very basic people, and this is probably what happened to the boss.
Right.
Okay. So it's almost like a nighttime sort of session type thing.
Right.
Kind of dusk is what I'm seeing.
Okay. I mean, whether it could have been like a Wicker Man type thing.
That's kind of, it's that kind of era. That kind of, it's very natural. It would be a paganistic kind of, this is giving back to work, giving to
work. Oh, I see, right. Okay, so it could be.
It's definitely not anything negative. It's not a negative feeling. It's not burning people.
So it needn't be like, I'm saying harvest, but maybe it was just like a solstice.
100%. It's definitely a natural thing.
Yeah.
It's definitely a natural thing. And I don't know if the year 43 lists in anything in history as well. I don't know what 16, 17, 18, 16, 17, 43. I'm hearing that as well. I'm talking.
Okay.
The only significant association to 43 is a recent planning application by Lord Seymour in 2018 with a decision made in 2020. This was for the restoration of the listed building immediately east of Gatcombe Mill House and the adjoining barn. Document 43 refers to the request for a static caravan to be erected on the property until such time as the derelict house becomes habitable. This area is also the reported site of several time slips, which we will explore in a future episode. Could it be that the spirits were objecting to something in the planned renovation? The land is also part of the Bury Pomeroy Castle estate.
Well, this is where the time slip happened about 3 years ago, where you had the couple from Totnes that went in there, and there was a priest holding a service, and all the people in there were all dressed in the medieval clothing.
Oh wow.
Yeah, time slip. Yeah, this has happened there. Yeah.
Do you understand? Was it Franciscan monks?
He put it on TripAdvisor, did he, the guy? But he saw people dressed in medieval clothing.
Monks. Franciscan monks.
The monks would have been in Tor Abbey. They would have.
Right, okay. I just heard Franciscans. So that's what I heard.
I don't think they were Franciscans there, but it's not to say that they were visiting.
Yeah, I don't know what I heard about that. I also felt that there was graves behind Margaret's Tower, outside. I know there's people, there's either graves there, or unmarked graves, or there's stone graves there. Because I'm seeing things, stones thrown at them.
Right.
I didn't see it myself, but they're telling me that it's happened.
Yeah, people have had stones thrown at them,
and
in the burning smell.
Right.
And you said just now about that being in the kitchen, but over here, that bit over there, as you go, the ground floor, that bit I had storage. There's stuff stored in there. That's how I got it. Oh,
is there?
It wasn't. I don't know.
Food stuff stored?
I don't know. There is food. Okay. But it was literally powerful. The two things were that way. But it felt to me that that whole area would have been used for storage. There was no main kitchen the bit I looked at. It was just storage stuff, though, I could say. I wasn't getting the hassle and bustle of the kitchen. This is more like a place you go down and people have to get something.
Lindy, to come here 50-odd years ago, remembers tunnels at the back, coming in from the valley, so halfway up the hillside, that gave them access beyond the wall, but she can't remember how she then got into the castle, but she definitely remembers a tunnel that got them from ground level to wall level here.
There was, I mean, Derek Seymour did say in his book at some point that there is a secret doorway.
Right.
And you would think there would be a secret way out of here if the front was covered by a way. It's never been under siege,
has it? Hasn't. So no. It wasn't ever needed. Like Bob said, there was no, it was built after that period where it would have been needed to be defensive, but interesting how she did mention that.
I think. Well, I have got some stuff written down about all that. But I think here, I think it was like political people brought and hidden here.
Right.
Because there's an old jailhouse as well in the woods up the back there, isn't there? Green Post Lane or something, and it's called.
Well, the hangman's hat.
But there's
where the crossroads is.
Yeah.
Just into the edge of the tree line.
There's actually a stone building.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one there. Yeah. And I think years ago they used to put people in there. Because there's also a hanging tree on that little lane that goes down to Stoke Gabriel from here.
Oh, there is, yeah. Because Kate said that as well.
Yeah.
So Kate's
went down there one night with a hood on.
Well done, Christine.
Yeah. At the dowsing rod, and I found the tree. I said, right, Rod's, and it was the hanging tree. So we're looking at it, something's telling you that that's...
Right. Sure.
This thing about the little girl...
Yeah.
...comes along here. There was a lady that was sat with her, sat down, covered with... She looked like she was reading a book.
Oh, I see.
Something like this.
Okay.
And it was almost like she was a nursemaid or somebody who was looking after this little girl.
Looking after the little girl, yeah.
Who skipped along and was humming and singing quite loudly as if she was deaf.
Oh, I see.
Make a different sort of sound.
Yeah.
And this was coming along. Some minutes later, there was a gentleman who was actually walking along here. And he said to me, it's funny, I thought I could just hear somebody skipping along here.
Oh, wow. Which
tied in with what I just heard. But Kevin and I was just talking in there, and you picked up on something in there which ties in a little bit, didn't you?
Oh, wow.
In the centre there, there's like some leaves in the corner. It almost feels like it's an open courtyard of some kind.
Okay.
There's a woman sat there, wearing all blue, with like a white thing on her head with a band around the top of her head.
Oh, wow.
And it's almost like her face is only visible, but she's sat down. And it's almost, I was doing this, she's doing needlework.
Oh, wow, that was just inside just the building.
Inside there, yeah.
Oh, right, oh, wow, yeah.
So
that's what you've experienced so far.
And we've been getting similar feelings and similar areas.
Yeah, so if anyone wants to sort of share everything that they've experienced today so far, and obviously over the years, and that would be fantastic.
What we saw was a figure of an elderly woman. She had a blue dress on, but you could see directly through her, and she was just staring at us, and this noise started.
But when you look in the direction where it actually happened, you can't see a thing. There was nothing there.
It screeched and stopped, and within a second, it was in the bush next to us.
There was this really amazing screech.
It scared the hell out of us.
and they felt there that there was a power far stronger than themselves, and became absolutely terrified and went.
And there must be a chalice and a cross.
Right.
Or a
panther. Yeah.
And there must be kept somewhere. Do you also understand stuff taken from here? Quite looted from here.
A lot of the brickwork, stonework, was over the years, it was treated as like a quarry when it was in ruins. And a lot of the houses, like Barton Pines down the lane, that's got windows taken from here.
Really?
Yeah. And supposedly the White Lady haunts that as well.
Apparently so, yeah.
So, and the some of the buildings in the manor house in Barry Pomeroy itself, that also has stone all taken from here. So, literally.
The whole building.
Yes, yeah.
I didn't see, I mean, I haven't seen or heard a White Lady or anything like that. There's a lady here walking around, but I do feel that there's still a bit chaotic. I just feel lots of different things. But
lots of different energies.
Over time,
yeah.
It's more layered, and it's kind of quite bigger one, and then suddenly it goes to something different. You know, there's a baby that didn't make it. Have you heard about anyone disappearing? Just disappearing from here as well? Where they just went, they just disappeared. Family member.
Well, as in here 1 minute, gone the next.
Yeah, just disappeared, walked off, don't come back.
Right. Not aware of
Isabella. Isabella or Isabella? I just heard the name.
Heard the name, Isabella,
And Charles. Charles or Charlie?
Charles. Yeah, recognised Charles. Yeah, it would be Charles, yeah.
Sir Edward Seymour, 3rd Baronet of Berry Pomeroy Castle, was an English politician who sat in the House of Commons at various times between 1640 and 1688. He fought for the Royalist cause in the English Civil War. He had 5 sons and 1 daughter. His 3rd son became Captain Charles Seymour. Not only that, the current Lord Seymour, who owns the castle estate, is called Francis Charles Edward Seymour, and he was born in 1956. 2 more notable Charleses are King Charles II, who praised the Seymours for their part in the Civil War, and Charles Kightley, the author of the English Heritage Red Guide to the Castle.
And has a vicar been seen in here?
Oh, yes, there is. Yeah, there is. Yeah, the time slip. Yeah, yeah. Really?
This is mine, this bit. So I don't know if people have ever had horses in here before.
Yeah, I think
that. It feels as if we should bring it.
A lot of people have actually had that experience where they've been told by. They've heard a man's voice and they've also heard a female's voice that's telling them what you're doing here.
This is mine.
This is mine, yeah. They're very possessive, you know, of their environment, aren't they?
As in firing up in a fireplace?
Not in a fireplace, no.
It's not fire, it's
I can smell it in here, so I don't know why I'm smelling it here, but it smells
like smoke. If it smells
like a fireplace there, that's got a...
I can't smell it in the fireplace, I can just smell it in the room. And
yeah, I can smell.
Well.
I don't say fire. I can smell something.
I've just had monk's bulk on.
Okay. There would have been monks around. This is like a chapel.
Yeah, that's where.
This is more where they would have hidden. They would have had to hide.
Right.
Was there a disagreement with monarchy with these people? Did they fall out of the monarchy?
Yeah,
you're within favour, and the mix you have a favour, and everything falls down. There is also when somebody tried to take this over, or tried to take this away, so instead of it being the normal family line, tried to be put into the part of family. Because I feel as if there's brothers battling, or uncles and nephews battling, somebody in the family battling for possession, and it just feels as if the There's a lady who can try and keep the peace, and this is a lady's area. I feel really for the lady here, whereas in the house it'd be battles to try and keep it going. And it's locked the doors, don't let them in. I think that's why shut the doors, don't let them in. If they get in, they're going to cause problems. So I don't understand it, but that's very much how it feels.
There's never like a siege or anything.
No, yeah,
like
it's
into,
a personal
into
family.
Squabbles.
Yeah, that's it. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's mine, you're not having it, so we'll take it anyway. Try and manipulate to get what they wanted.
Yeah,
there was quite a lot of squabbles.
The breakdown in the family.
Yeah.
I don't know if part of the house was taken by
I think it was a little bit dysfunctional as well. There was a dysfunctional, at times.
In December 1547, Berry Pomeroy was bought from the impoverished Sir Thomas Pomeroy by the wealthy and powerful Edward Seymour, Duke of Somerset. Seymour was the brother of Henry VIII's third and favourite queen, Jane Seymour. He became Lord Protector of his nine-year-old nephew, King Edward VI, and thus effectively ruler of England. The Berry Pomeroy estate was Seymour's most valuable single acquisition, but it was only one of the many properties he gathered during his rise to power. He may never even have visited the castle, and certainly his ownership was short-lived as he was executed in January 1552. However, because there were doubts about his legitimacy, the junior branch of a Seymour family, descendants of the protector by his second wife, enjoyed their principal lands and titles, while the senior Berry Pomeroy branch was sidelined. This situation was clearly a constant source of annoyance to the Berry Pomeroy Seymours. Later, their ambitious building programme may indeed have been prompted by a desire to score off the junior branch of the family.
Oh, this is where
is
you
that
got
Tony?
Me.
That's,
yeah.
Lush.
So, what did you get here again, Lee?
I've
got the photo. The photograph you showed me earlier. Yeah.
Your bell ringing.
Might be the church.
Yeah.
Just down the road.
I'm not focusing on the church at all. That's the thing. Would you know if there's a young girl here with long, blonde, light brown or blonde, curly hair?
That rings a bell.
She's only young, I'm not seeing her old.
Isabella.
Young.
Isabella.
I don't know, I'm just seeing that face at the moment.
Yeah, it's Isabella. She's blonde, curly hair. Are you getting a very young girl?
I'm seeing
a
teenage. Maybe younger?
It could be
Isabella. But she's not showing me as the older lady, she's not seeing the younger girl.
When you say blonde, curly hair, that's familiar, because Isabella apparently has got blonde, curly hair. She wears a bonnet most of the time, but
just seeing the moment. What would be down that side?
That's one of the
gatehouse.
The
whole thing really about this place is amazing. The ghosts that occur here.
We had a strange feeling there was something wrong. It just started getting pretty weird.
It's always been very still, as though you're waiting for something to happen.
You learn to control your imagination, because at Berry Pomeroy, if you let your imagination run away with you, you could be a raving lunatic.
This is definitely not a fire here.
We heard musky smell earlier, didn't we? We heard Paul and Sandra sitting there. We heard them.
Destroyed it.
No, we wouldn't have destroyed it, but we'd be consequential if we noted that it happened.
Right. Some
kind of fire. I can still smell the smoke, which means there'd been a fire of some sort here.
Yeah?
And there was royalty here, wasn't there?
Yeah, there was, yeah. There's quite a lot of royalty here, actually.
There's been something in, I don't know if there's something in the courtyard thing that's special because of them, but I feel as if that's where they would have been addressed. And it's also a log of people who have, people stole from them and that sort of stuff. Is there a log of anything like that?
I don't know. There is there?
They've been excommunicated from the family or from the house because...
Not sure. Possibly it's in the history books. Can't recall anything offhand.
So when you understand a book that's got all the illuminated writing around the outside that links to the history of this place. So it's all in script, scrolled writing, but it's illuminated like monks' writing. It's about the history of the family and everything.
I'd say that it would have been, yeah, obviously.
Possibly, yeah, I don't know where it would be now, but there's certainly the book that Derek Seymour did. He did, like, family trees.
Right.
So he obviously got those from somewhere.
Yeah, it's illuminated, like it's got the green writing, and the gold and everything, so it's very much like the family Bible, except it's a family history kind of thing. But I know there's two brothers that really didn't get on. I feel as if they're they both want to be the biggest and they want
Thomas.
To be the
best. And
they're going to do whatever they got to do. And I know there was not a great outcome out of that. And I also know that there was that carried on for generations. There was still the battle was going on in the family for generations. Right. They hated each other because the other one was wrong. And they were mummy's boy, one of them as well. Who said that? Have they been talking about a lady in the front walking in the garden picking flowers?
Someone mentioned that a couple of years ago. They're picking roses. There's a little girl that apparently she carries a basket, a straw basket, and she pods people with a stick. Apparently. That's a legend.
I can see someone picking flowers.
Yeah.
It wasn't the greatest of family dynamics, and I think that. But then with money, they must be short with your money as well. They must have lost a lot, and they were fighting to keep everything going.
Yeah.
And then I don't know if they lost the house in the end, but I do know that it was like the.
I think they did,
I'll take the house. If you don't lose the house, I'll destroy it myself. Well, no one else is having it.
The result of that, a lot of it was never complete. Like this facade here was never probably finished to live in. Properly.
But there was about keeping image. Everyone had to see as if they were still high powered, had the money. And whatever. So if you've got the outside here, this shows that I'm strong because I've got a battlement, but in reality, it's the side, it's not as it seems.
Yeah. And that's why a lot of the stories, like the brothers going over the battlements, they would have incorporated that into their own history.
You've magnified it 100%. Yeah. But there was definitely something, definitely crying of something like that.
During the first decade of the 17th century, work began on transforming Lord Seymour's mansion into a very stately house, comparable with the great contemporary houses being built elsewhere in England. This was the work of his son, Edward Seymour II, who inherited Berry Pomeroy in 1593. Immense in scale and ambition, the project involved not only the replacement of the old house's north range by a grand staircase and galleries leading to new rooms in the east range, but also the raising of a stupendous new north wing, three stories high. It's not clear why Edward wanted to undertake such extravagant building works on a rather cramped and unsuitable site, nor how he intended to fund them. Eventually, building came to an abrupt halt. By June 1611, he was certainly in serious financial trouble, though only a month later, he made a last contribution to his family's fragile status by purchasing a baronetcy.
You've got the guy with the pike over here?
Yeah.
Oh, right, okay.
On the other side of that as well, I felt really a lot of sorrow from yeah, it's like she lost a child just around the corner.
Oh yeah, there's a story about that, isn't she? That she actually had an incestuous affair with her father, didn't she?
Oh right. Okay.
The lady in blue, and she didn't want the child, and she killed it.
Yeah. She was remorseful, saying, "No, my son, rather, like that." And I just noticed the water as well, so I don't know if that's part of it as well. I know that this is just, I kept staring out that way when I was doing it.
All right. It's got quite overgrown over the years.
Nicholas.
Oh, Nicholas, Nick.
So I don't know if that's a family name.
Like
a Dutch or a Belgian name linked to this place. There's a foreign name linked to this page, but it feels like Belgian, French,
right.
That kind
yeah,
of
thing. French, Normandy. Normandy, yes. The Pomeroy.
I feel almost like Flemish, French, Belgium.
French, yeah. Normandy, yeah. That's where the Pomeroy family were from.
Music map walking through here.
Is this where you're picking up the music?
Medieval music.
You're picking up the music. Wow.
Did this come through?
And you were hearing like a flute, was it like all that? And like harpsichord.
Harpsichord stuff. It's weird.
Oh, wow.
Through here, I said to Christine, I was like, what's that?
Oh, wow.
That makes sense.
It's along here. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah. This is the kitchen.
The kitchen's, yeah, inside there as well. I think that's what they use for the storage.
Where's the rose garden?
The rose garden? I'm not sure. Do you know where the rose garden is?
Rose garden.
Look in the ladies' garden, which
had all flowers. Do you guys smell anything?
I think.
It's not
even scented.
It's good.
It can smell like a lemon.
I was going to say scented.
Yeah, scented, yeah.
Manifest.
I can smell like lemon. Lemon.
David, can you?
I just heard about rose garden.
There must be a place
where
ladies go.
Weird as you said that,
because
I was
thinking. Yeah, well, we said it at the same time. But it's like a lemon. I mean, I can smell like a lemon kind of smell, citrus smell. Mm. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's storage.
That'd probably be like storage sort of ovens, wouldn't it? Yeah.
That would explain the middle of my back pain then. I feel like I've been punched in the middle of my back.
Oh, really?
So I just see someone like laid out. I can't work it out if it's a male or female on the floor there.
Oh, on the floor, right, okay. They're picking up on a female that's fallen onto the floor here.
Okay. That looks like the sitting of a chair.
There's
a male people on the on the dress.
Oh, she slept on the dress, right, yeah.
Cause I'm still coming down.
So what era is she in?
I
want
to say like 1690 to 1700, around that kind of time period.
I just don't like the pain in my back.
It's quite sore.
Take that away.
And that's only just happened since you walked in?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
We both got the same time, that one. It feels like punched in the middle of your back, and it's just like push your back.
Oh, wow. That's fascinating.
Take it away, please.
Yeah. And you're getting it as well, Kevin, are you?
Yeah, it's not nice.
No.
So we were talking about it with Bob earlier, that women in particular, when they come here, not knowing about the history of the place, often find period cramps coming on.
You have stomach pain like I had when you started over here just now. Yeah.
So maybe it's not just a female thing,
clairsentience, feeling.
Yeah.
So they'll give you the sensations. It's the same as when you're working, if you've got somebody who had problems with kidneys, you get a pain in the kidneys.
Right.
So they're giving you a sensation, but it's like, when I start working and walking around, my stomach starts spinning, and my stomach is right over there. But this is just literally feels like, as soon as you mentioned about seeing someone on the floor, then the pain kicks in my back.
Yeah.
And that's when I could understand where you were, because you had the same pain. It's quite cool that I linked together.
But you say you see like a, she's falling over a long dress.
It's like a long dress, and it's almost like she took a step down and she's just gone. But I feel her hands weren't free. She had something in her hands as well, and she's ended up here, face down.
So yeah,
face down.
One of the chef, yeah, cook or an assistant maybe.
Who's a tray?
Carrying stuff.
A tray, yeah.
Yeah.
Makes sense because it's like tripped, gone, can't stop because hands.
Yeah.
It's just
Head as
well. She's
working.
Just
skirt.
Yeah.
Skirts.
Does that make sense?
It's
yeah.
Skirt. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, pretty much, if you've got a skirt like that, you're going to be tripping over, I would have thought, quite a lot.
Yeah.
I'd skirt
your
name as well.
Did you pick up any names, anybody? Or?
Mary.
I'll get Mary.
Mary.
Oh,
Mary.
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 Also, do you know what I'm saying? Like, you're saying about skirts, but I can see a skirt, I can see a candle with a skirt. I see that as well, but I don't think that would be documented. I've just seen there's lots of different instances.
Yeah.
And it's just lots of different layers.
Layers, isn't it?
Tim, you can't go up there.
Well, you can have a go, you give each other a bunk.
Yeah, I don't think so.
This doesn't look like an internal wall, does it? It's quite messy, as though it is external, suggesting that this bit could well have been added on again at some point.
It feels, I'd say,
I don't know, some sort of hallway with stairs. That's what it feels like. Mm. Well, you've got the, because you've got the holes where you're on the beams
coming down at an angle.
Yeah, coming down,
right?
Yeah.
To me, I reckon it came round, curled around, got all there, curled around, came down again. Yeah, and you thought, that's what it seems like to me.
They are.
It is,
like, because
it's just
how
those
holes are.
Yeah.
Coming down at an angle.
Yeah.
That really
is, isn't it?
Does it feel busy in here? Do you get that feeling?
It feels like there's lots
sort of
quite, I can imagine quite.
Yeah. A lot of people always get that it feels very busy, like as if they're cooking their dinners, the chefs are in there.
Yeah, back again.
Back again,
yeah.
Yeah, I can smell that. I can smell that just now. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I can actually smell that. Actually, it's clear as day.
Is there a water source? I know we got the river. Is there a way of water source to the car, to the house?
No, that's the way Bob said that there's no records of where they got the water from, apart from the river. There's no well, nothing like that.
Smell now.
Awful smell. Yeah.
Well, I was I think you smell something.
Wendy, who was here earlier, she remembers coming here about 50 years ago and seeing like a tunnel on the hillside
right.
that they came through up onto the level here outside the walls.
It would make sense.
So, yeah, if that's where the water came from, then they would need an easy entrance and exit, rather than get all the way around the outside of the building.
You wouldn't build a castle on the hill, just have no water source.
No.
You'd have it so you can get it up the hill.
Yeah.
So there's got to be something else there.
Yeah.
But I know there's bolt holes on, doesn't it? Frustrating me out, bolt hole. There's got to be some other way we can play through.
A strong room. It's almost like a room where no windows or doors, just one door, so they would go valuables and stuff.
Yeah, something to keep secure, and nobody can get in or out without.
They've got one at Cuntil, I think, haven't they?
Sorry.
Do you know when someone's being marched somewhere, almost like with the drum, they're being marched to the exit?
Funny you say that, yeah. Jim Luxton picked that up last year, the drumming,
that kind of being marched. A punishment.
That's what he heard last year, the drumming, you know, when the stones were hitting him from Margaret's Tower. Like, that was about a year ago. Oh, he's getting sad, is he? All right, you're high. What did you experience?
It's fine.
Right there.
Yeah. What's happened?
You put your hand there, that feel it.
Before.
You feel that?
Feel it,
that point, and then there's that breeze.
Yeah, I can feel that. Icy cold, yeah. And you fit pins and needles on your fingers.
It's not just the breeze coming through, because it's warm here.
Yeah.
But it's icy cold.
Icy cold here. Can you feel it, David?
Cold here, yeah.
Just here. But it's like an icy cold.
It's nice and warm here.
Feels like you walked into a freezer.
Yeah.
And then you walk straight into that cold spot.
Yeah.
But it's not because the wind's coming from there, because that would still affect where David is.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can feel that on my face. Yeah.
Gentleman's area, but I don't.
Okay.
We do know that.
Not sure what this. Again, still got the fireplace. Yeah.
But this felt like the man's area. I don't know about you, but I felt like this is where the man would be, like the office, like the men would go for a smoke.
Yeah.
It's like the smoking room where the gentlemen retire after dinner. They come and sit in here and talk about the women. Did they keep horses on this ground?
Yeah, they did, because the stables were at the back of the castle.
That way?
Yeah, that way, yeah. A lot of people that have come here, they've actually heard the horses' hooves. Okay. They've heard the horses neighing as well.
There must be somewhere nearby that does honey.
Honey, yeah, yeah.
Bees?
I've heard about that, yeah.
I'm hearing about honey.
Yeah,
I've seen lights in the woods
I've never seen any lights in the woods, no. Have you, Lee? Have you seen lights in the woods? No.
Sometimes
it's usually.
It's got no, like, a lantern or something, yeah. Just traipsing through.
I'll tell you what people have seen. People have walked along that lane down there and they've actually looked up at the castle, right. The windows from the other side, and they've seen a lantern shining through the windows.
I guess there's someone played for stuff that wasn't really on the light side. Did you understand there's any mystery about something being kicked out for doing that or causing problems?
Well, are we talking like devil worship or?
Well, I'm talking about not traditional church.
Right, okay.
I'm talking about going against what the family would do. So it's almost as if there was somebody who's talking to me, especially with that family. Do you understand my mood? You get the French text.
It's like a dark side to they would have known that they did it, but it was all kind of hushed up a little bit as well.
Yeah,
they kind of let them do it, but as long as it didn't enter.
Or when they found out they're doing it, they kicked them.
Yeah. Well, we're talking about the difference between Catholics and Protestants then.
I was originally getting that with, but when I said earlier about the quiet chapel, the private chapel.
Right, yeah.
But it definitely feels darker, as if somebody dabbled with
alcohol. Like a little bit darker, yeah. Not like magic then, but like paganism?
But that would be classed as magic.
Right.
It would have classed as magic back then. So I would say it was on the darker side of what they should be doing. That's how it feels to me. But then the problem is, there's a lot of that around. There's a lot of that around here.
Yeah. So see, that could be what's going on prior to the building being put here. Because a lot of what we've heard or are learning is that there was something on a psychic level was happening here before the building
right,
was
okay,
put
that makes
here.
Sense, then.
And that's what, you know, has pervaded, the fact that it's crossing ley lines and stuff like that.
We were talking earlier mentioned about Monty Python.
Yeah, that's right.
Same box thing, it's very much old folklore.
Understand.
So, very much of an old folklore kind of thing, mummifying a cat, putting it in the house of good luck or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
It's that
yeah.
kind of thing I'm getting. I'm not getting like hexes on people to kill them.
No.
It's much more about providing luck, providing protection, but not the way the church would do
it. It's frowned upon.
Yeah,
but it's like a wives' tale.
Old hag. Yeah.
Yeah, that, you know, people would tolerate. But back then it was much more witchcraft
yeah, back in the day, yeah. That was frowned upon, wasn't it, witchcraft back in their days. You'd be burnt at the stake, wouldn't you, back in their days. And
the crumbling walls of this once great fortress are perched above the desolate moors that blanket southern England. It is a land of ancient superstitions, defiled tombs, and long abandoned graveyards.
is just brooding and evil. The evil is there in the atmosphere.
But is it only atmosphere? Sightings has teamed up with Tony Cornell, Great Britain's premier paranormal investigator, for the first in-depth study ever conducted at Barry Pomeroy Castle.
In my view, it's one of the most interesting cases I think I've come across, basically because so many people have seen things and felt things. You don't get that in all hauntings. You waste a lot of time, but there's enough evidence that I've heard that we've got to examine this.
Cornell's first step was to gather historical and anecdotal data. He sought out historian Derek Seymour, who has studied the ghostly presences here for more than 70 years.
Every day I thought of this castle. If it was a lovely sunny day, I used to think, I wonder what it's looking like at the castle today. If there was a thunderstorm and the wind was howling, I used to think, oh, I wouldn't like to be at the castle today. Oh, no.
It's funny, someone would draw in the ash out of the fire,
yeah.
You weren't allowed to do that.
That's why I keep wanting to play looking at fire.
You just keep playing at fire watching
and
drawing the ash and the fire.
Yeah, I'm getting that a little bit as well.
It's
the old stairwell through here.
Anything from this? It feels like it's been hit across the top of the head, just feel very heady in
there. That one, that's really.
Oh yeah, second, yeah.
That
door,
yeah.
Very top
of the
top
right. Oh, the top right. Okay, so we're looking at that one there.
But I'm focusing on
that. Oh yeah, so what, you're picking up on a... You're picking on something, are you, or someone?
See, you don't know who lived in these parts. You said you don't know who's had what parts, do you?
No.
Because I want routine of walking down here. I want somebody who'd walk in. So it goes out of routine every day, I guess.
All I can see is just like, again, more in my mind's eye, as a man up there wearing like stockings. Is that just, and yeah, the dark blue kind of velvety kind of pantaloon. Same with the matching jacket with buttons, and his hair's kind of bobbed. He's almost got like a flat kind of thing with a little tassel coming down, and he's just looking back. He's almost like peering around a corner and then stepping back.
That's what he's seeing.
Oh, right. Like
just up in that top
door. Oh, right.
It's almost like...
Repeat.
It's like looking out, stepping back. Quite vivid images. There's a bit of gold in his... You know, he seems quite well to do as well.
Have you seen a field or family first?
Funnily enough, that's what Christina had with her in her bag, was both family crests. Kind of Zalia, which was red and gold.
Yeah.
Right.
With the guy with the pike one.
And oh,
I
yeah.
If you were to say crest out, I would say it's definitely, sorry, orange and red, not orange and gold.
Right, okay.
And orange and red. And I want to say it's like fleur-de-lis on one side, and on the other side is quite blank.
Right.
That's all I would say. I'd get the
so I got the red, I got the red gold on the police bag. So, I don't know, I've, that was showing that as well. Alright. Baby,
it's good.
The best known ghost here is the White Lady. And the White Lady is, of course, the unfortunate Lady Margaret, who is seen to walk at the top of the stairs in that tower and down in the dungeon. She is really quite frequently seen.
Folklore tells of two sisters in love with the same man. Lady Margaret, the younger and more beautiful of the two, was imprisoned in the castle's dungeon by her jealous sister. There, she starved to death. Modern-day visitor Anne Benny recalls her encounter with the White Lady.
When we first went down the stairs into the chamber, it was dark, it was damp, and it wasn't a nice place to be. But then this evil presence, you could sense it was evil. I don't know how to describe it any other way, really. And then I heard the footsteps, very quick, very light, and the closer she got, the more panic-stricken I felt. I just wanted to get out of the place and not come back.
Mm-hmm.
Bob's got a theory that some people call this, this is the Margaret's Tower, right?
Right.
But the Margaret Pomeroy from history obviously wasn't a saint.
Right.
So the tower is named after Saint Margaret, who was the patron saint of childbirth.
Okay.
And mothers. So his theory is that when a woman was pregnant, when she was going into labour, she was put in a quiet place, i.e. St. Margaret's Tower, and then she was like excommunicated from the church, as it were, because it was like, you know, she was ill and she was dirty and wasn't regarded as part of the religious family while she was in childbirth.
Okay.
And so after she'd given birth, she had to be reconnected to the church. And the chapel in the gatehouse would have been where she would have been taken to, okay, after having given birth. Wearing white nightdress, she'd been processed along the ramparts to go to church to come back into the family.
Okay.
And so what Bob thinks is it's a reenactment or recording of that process being carried out, and not necessarily a random ghost.
Okay.
So there's like a historical meaning behind what people are seeing.
Yeah.
And that's what's given rise to the white lady myth.
Right.
So it's a celebration of birth,
yes,
rather than an omen of death.
Yeah,
sort of
It makes a lot of sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yes.
So that would mean actually.
Or this whole thing would have had different floors and different.
Yeah. But going up there, so that would be a whole floor of rooms going around.
Yeah. You can see this is the staircase that I was talking about. You can see it actually goes up there.
Yeah, yeah. Goes to your right. I'll just be. So I'm getting people from that door there, and you were getting them from the other door above it. But I'm just wondering if that's where there were like siblings that were on separate floors to keep them separate. Okay. If they weren't getting on. So that's why I'm kind of feeling like I can see a wife. I've got a girl on that floor.
Oh, yeah.
Because you had a lad on the top
floor. Yeah. Yeah, this the night that we did our investigation here. This is where they had one of the shrine meeting things that kept going off. And so one of the guys came and sat with it in the end because we were fed up just coming back and forwards. And this is where he got stones thrown at him.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Oh, my God.
I'm not surprised.
Which is quite a common occurrence. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
This is
like an open at some point.
Yeah,
like an open courtyard.
The windows, they've got to be looking at something. They won't be looking inside a building.
Because that's where that woman's doing the sewing over there in the corner.
Oh, that's where you picked up on the lady doing the sewing.
With
her,
you just see her face.
Oh, right. So she's just sewing over there.
Blue, but white. And she's just sat there sewing.
Is there links to wolves as well,
Pierre? Wolves? So I don't know. There is a picture on my page of a wolf that someone captured at the castle, but I don't know.
This family thing. I don't know. It's
I'm not sure.
Because one of the things about this place, you can't see it.
No.
Yeah.
Only when you come down the drive or down in the valley, you don't see it. Apart from Dartington Hall.
Really?
Yeah, Totnes. There's a place in the grounds, Dartington Hall, you get a clear view of the castle.
Oh, wow.
And Bob is like, you know, one family trying to outdo the other. Yeah. You know, we've got a nice house here, but we're going to do a bloody great big castle over here as well, and you'll be able to see it.
Yes.
Yeah.
I want to write these graves. I'm talking about this bit here.
Okay.
There's something around here. And the fact, I don't know if it's baby grapes.
Back again, that smell.
Yeah. Well, now I've got primrose smell.
coming over. But this, when we did our investigation, the last nighttime when they allowed in here, just walking down these steps, glanced up into the second window down,
yep.
And the left-hand corner, there was a light.
Oh, okay.
And then it disappeared, almost as though a door had been shut, blocking out the light.
Of course, yeah.
There's no floors.
No.
But definitely
saw
that. That top row of windows, you can't see the light through it.
No.
Almost like there's a ceiling to it.
Exactly, yeah. But there isn't, look, the other ones.
No. Why is that one different?
Yeah, I just noticed that as well.
You look, go back inside and look up, you might see.
Yeah. Overhang, possibly. Yeah, it's a very great lintel sticks out over the top.
Oh, is it? Oh, right.
So that's why it's so dark.
I'd imagine that'd be the best in the house if I'd put the rooms there.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
Because
all depends, yeah, yeah. Well, I say it would be a big, you know, a big household, wouldn't it? There'd be a lot of people living there.
Any graves
right
here?
Oh!
High five.
Graves. Oh, yeah, you picked up on the graves earlier, didn't you?
Graves.
Yeah, graves.
Here.
It's here.
Yeah, here. Saying graves.
And there's baby. There's baby the grave. I know there is. Yeah. But there's, you wouldn't normally have had it, you'd have it in the church, normally. But
yeah, normally, but here it is.
I don't know if it's been a hidden one. One that didn't.
Okay.
But definitely, I've said back graves here, and they didn't have any. So I'm really pleased you did say that.
Yeah, and people have actually taken loads of photographs on the grass, and graves have magically appeared on their photos, and when there's no graves on the grass.
It's behind the tower, is what I got.
Yeah.
Bronwyn got a picture.
Yeah.
Looking through the window there.
Right.
This is where there's a figure. Standing sort of here.
Here.
But it's like possibly like baggy sleeves, but it's all like bright pinks and mauves.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
So coloured rather than misty sort of shape.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I do believe spirits can appear solid, they don't always appear as misty shapes.
They can depend on
energy. Yeah, and if they want to do. If they want to show themselves. Because they can choose how they want to show themselves, can't they?
Yeah, we always say that limitations are endless because we choose our own limitations. Spirit, God, they can do what they want.
There's a lot, yeah, you've got a lime kiln down there as well. But I'm not sure where the well is. We'll have to try and do a bit of research on that because. They must have had to go somewhere to get their water.
Go here again, it is on the left hand side, but more so my neck.
Right, okay. So, whereabouts are you left hand side?
Yeah.
Exactly the same. Yeah. It feels like I'm being squeezed and pushed in the bottom of my ribs in my side there.
Wow.
And pushing it right way around there. But you're getting it.
Yeah,
so if you're getting it, that's good.
And you're getting it as well, so there must be something, isn't it?
I don't know
if it is,
I'm just feeling
it. It's very, I mean, I know it's a small space, but it doesn't feel very...
I wouldn't want to be isolated. Yeah.
No. You literally feel like fight or flight mode in here.
Yeah, that's...
But it's kind of like, what purpose does this... Apart from like an observation point, it's got good views out over the valley.
But what's the purpose of the whole that?
Isn't it?
Well, yeah. Yeah.
You can't get nothing through it, you couldn't
be dependent on
anything with it.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's, here
you've
got a door here. Yeah. Yeah, a big front, like, you look around the panel, it's almost like, bigger. It's a pumpkin, isn't it? It's an only just. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. You're not going to go in,
but if
you're
going to
have this,
you'd have to
step.
Would it be like a little cell block?
It could have been, or it could have been a storage room, maybe.
Together, This documentary was just part of a larger spiritual investigation undertaken by a team of psychic mediums and paranormal investigators in April, May, and July of 2023. Their time was given freely to the project so that the experiences of unexplained activity and manifestations could be recorded for future reference. Almost three decades on from the original short exposé on the sightings episode in 1994, Berry Pomeroy Castle still makes an engaging and unique visitor experience. There are plenty more people to see in our future episodes, including insights from historian Bob Mann. This is a non-profit enterprise. All participants are volunteers, including me. I'm the editor and producer. Matt Kerbyson, the creator and director, thanks you for taking the time to watch our film. Please consider subscribing to my channel. This is entirely free and supports all of the creators. See you soon for part three.
It's not just the castle itself that people feel is haunted. It's the whole area around the village.
The whole area, yeah.
The valley below and the woods and everything. And
definitely.
I've heard it described as a cloud that just descends on the whole vicinity.
Father was walking down one night and Lady Margaret just, it was a full moon, Lady Margaret just walked straight across, floated straight across.
Floated, yeah.
No, do you? Here, to be honest, anything can happen. Yeah, and it really is. It really is like that. Anything can happen.
Because it was solid, I couldn't see through it, so it felt like it was going to hit me. But it was about here. It wasn't like too high.
Get what it means.